35, and we're late getting started, so let's get going. My name is Pat Moulton, and I'm a secretary of the Vermont Agency of Commerce and Community Development, who is administering the $10 million loan fund that we are affectionately referring to as the Windham County Economic Development Program. And with me this evening is Joe Bradley, who is the CEO of the Vermont Economic Development Authority, and Kathy Polimis, who... Cassie Polimis. What's your title exactly, Cassie?
Director of Operations.
Thank you. Director of Operations for the Vermont Economic Development Authority. And Fred Kenny, Executive Director, Executive Director of the Vermont Economic Progress Council. And to explain our roles a little bit as Secretary of the Agency, I'm going to sit down if anybody doesn't mind. I feel way too formal standing up here. We are defining and developing the process for applying for the funds that are coming from Entergy Corporation for Windham County. Fred's organization will actually be the intake point for any applications, and Fred's going to talk about that in a minute. And we're here tonight mainly to speak about the possibility of a revolving loan fund for Windham County that would be administered by the Vermont Economic Development Authority. And just, we're going to try to keep introductory remarks to a minimum so we have time to hear from all of you. I would ask, if you haven't signed in, please do, so we know who you are and how to get in touch with you for any kind of follow-up information. If you wish to speak tonight, there's a place on the sign-up sheet to indicate that, and we'll call in the order in which everyone signed up. When we get through the sign-up sheet, we'll then open it up to any other questions and comments. We really hope to hear from you tonight about what you would like to see in terms of a revolving loan fund for this region. But let me start by explaining a few things. As you know, hopefully, Entergy Corporation, through the agreement with the state of Vermont, is providing $10 million in economic development funds for Windham County specifically. It's coming in the form of $2 million a year over the next 5 years that will be paid to our agency, and then we will dole that out, if you will, through an application process that Fred will describe in a minute. We have not made any decisions about what portion of these funds should be utilized for grants or for loans, other than we know we're going to be able to do both, grants and loans. For any of you who were at the luncheon yesterday with Governor Shumlin, he was very clear for for-profit businesses and how the program is set up, for-profit businesses would seek loans, other organizations would seek grants. And there may be other organizations, nonprofits, et cetera, who might wish to also have a loan. That's perfectly fine. But at the moment, we're not planning on having for-profit businesses receive grants. As I said yesterday, and I'll say again, that's at the moment. Any of our process is not cast in concrete at this point, but that's our rough design. What we're doing is hearing from you folks yesterday and from you folks tonight before we put the final touches on any sort of final design for the use of this funding. And we may adjust as we are in process. We may decide after the first round, well, this didn't work so much, or that worked great, or we're missing this, and we can adjust and make changes to the program as time goes on. We're not bound by any federal law with this money. We're only bound by the MOU, which clearly states the funding is for economic development in Windham County. And part of the goals are to work to replace the economic activity being lost by the closure of Vermont Yankee, including the jobs that are being lost and the economic opportunities that the facility brings and the economic activity it generates here in Windham County. We're here tonight mainly to talk about what we might want to do in terms of revolving loan funds. We want to hear from you. What kinds of things would you like to see us be doing on the loan front? If you have ideas for specific tools or opportunities that we should avail ourselves in the loan program, we're anxious to hear those from you. We've got some ideas, but we want to hear from you all as to what you think. And this is funding that will remain in Windham County in perpetuity. And as the governor said yesterday, one of the benefits of providing loans and not grants is that it revolves. As those loans are repaid, it comes back into the fund to be loaned out again, and hopefully these funds last far longer than the 5 years that Entergy will be paying the $2 million a year. So that's the purpose of tonight. We're happy to answer questions. I'd like to turn it over to Jo Bradley so she can explain what VITA is. Before I do that, let me just say, Fred will describe the process, but part of why we at the Agency of Commerce are doing this program is because we have infrastructure in place already. We have staff that deal with grants every day, literally, through our Vermont Community Development Program and others. We have people who, we have systems that can take in applications, so you don't have to develop that infrastructure here regionally. And that means that more money can go out to economic development activities in the region versus you having to spend maybe 10%, who knows what, to staff up yourself to do that. And that's the same is true for VITA. At our agency, we are not charging an administrative fee for this work. We're doing it with existing staff. We're absorbing any expenses that we may have in our existing budget so that, again, the dollars can be out in the region and working in the community to help create the jobs that are being lost as a result of the closure of the Vermont Yankee nuclear power plant. With that, I'd ask Joe to give us a few minutes on what the Vermont Economic Development Authority is, and then Fred will describe the general process as we believe it will work today, again, subject to additional comment and feedback from all of you.
Thank you. Excuse me, and if I can't speak very loudly, and if I cough a lot, I'm not contagious, it's just allergies. We all know it's been a really bad allergy season. VITA is the Vermont Economic Development Authority. We're an authority, we're not a state agency. We're what's called a quasi-public instrumentality. We have about $240 million in assets. We're a lending authority. We are, in essence, the lending authority for the state of Vermont. We make loans to very small businesses. The largest loan that we can make right now, sorry, how's that? Better? Okay. The largest loan that we can make in our large loan program is $1.5 million. We have a large agricultural portfolio, and in that portfolio we make loans as small as $10,000. So we really run the whole gamut. As I said, our assets right now are about $240 million. We have a staff of 35. We are governed by a board of directors of 15 people from through all over the state. In addition to, I think we have 5 ex officios now. We have the state treasurer, we have Pat as Secretary of Commerce, we have the state Secretary of Agriculture, we have the Commissioner of Energy. Public Service. And we have the Commissioner of Forest, Parks, and Recreation. So we really do all kinds of lending to all kinds of businesses and to nonprofits as well. I'm here to listen, to hear what you all think about what you'd like to see a loan fund look like. So I will stop there and wait for your questions or thoughts.
And I could just interject before we turn the floor over to Fred. The intent, too, is that we make sure that projects that are going to seek funding are leveraging other existing sources, such as VITA's existing loan programs, such as revolving loan programs, such as the one the town of Brattleboro has or the town of Rockingham has, so that we can leverage as many dollars as possible into a specific project. And there is technical assistance that can help folks identify what those sources of funds are through organizations like the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation, the Small Business Development Center, et cetera. So I'll let Fred describe the process as we envision it at this time, subject to change, of course. And just a reminder, if for those who came in late, if you would please sign in so we can capture your contact information so we can follow up with any information. And if you wish to speak, please indicate on the sheet. We're going to have folks speak in the order of which they signed up. So, and the sign-up sheet's right over there on the table.
I'm Fred Kenny, Executive Director of the Vermont Economic Progress Council. It's a council made up of 11 citizens from around the state. Steve Morse from this area is the chair of that board right now. VEPSI is currently responsible for considering and approving applications for the state's business incentive program. So we deal with business applications, and we also handle the state's tax increment financing district program, which deals primarily with municipal infrastructure, financing for municipal infrastructure. So that's just a little background on what the VEPSI board does, because as staff, we'll be handling the application process, but the VEPSI board is also involved in the review process. So in a few, within a couple of weeks, we'll release, the agency will release a notice of funding availability for the first round of funding, as I think Pat mentioned, is $2 million each fiscal year for 5 years. So the first round will be applications for that first $2 million. If the first round of funding does not allocate all of the $2 million, we'll have a second round in the spring, and that'll happen each year for 5 years. So once the notice of funding availability is released, that it will include an application along with the NOFA, it's called, and we'll be accepting applications will be due 60 days after the NOFA is released. And all both applications, both kinds of applications, whether it's from a business for a loan or from other types of entities for a grant, will come to the same application and will come to the same place. Get initial review by myself and my staff, which is one other person, and for completeness and responding back to the applicant, and making sure the application is complete. There'll be a time period where you can submit some more information if it's not complete. And I should back up a little bit. Before the applications are due, we'll be working with the SBDC, the BDCC, and I'm sorry to throw all these acronyms out there.
Small Business Development
Center, the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation, and the Wyndham Regional Commission. We'll be working with them to make sure that they're providing, that they can provide technical assistance to the various applicants, depending on what kind of an application it is, so that they can get an application ready for this round or a future round. So then the applications will be due in 60 days after it's released. There'll be an initial review for completeness and whether the application has met some threshold criteria. And those are whether the project would fulfill one of the promotes economic development in Wyndham County, because that's the goals of the fund. And the other threshold criteria is that the project meets a goal or objective that's been identified by the SEDS, the SEVEDS report.
So those comprehensive economic development strategy.
Yeah. So if it meets those two threshold criteria, it'll be sent on to, we have about 10 people at the agency in various capacities who have worked in CDBG, Community Development Block Grant Program, with municipal planning grants, other type of grant and loan programs that have experience with reviewing applications, and they'll, depending on, and in the Department of Economic Development, there's about 10 people total. And depending on what the application is about, certain people will be assigned to that application to do the scoring. So there'll be three people from that pool of scorers assigned to each application to do scoring. Based on the scoring criteria, I have some copies of that here, and I'll leave some copies at the end of tonight, but it's also on the
govermont.gov
website. So we've set up a special website for this program. And right now, the application will be on there, obviously, when it's ready. But right now, the scoring criteria are on there. And there's also a document on there that kind of is questions and answers, a frequently asked questions document that covers a lot in more detail what we're going to cover tonight. So it goes to the scoring team to do scoring on the criteria. And at the same time, we'll send it out to sister agencies that are appropriate for the particular kind of application. We have lead people that will respond and review the applications from Department of Agriculture, the Public Service Department, A&R, and VTrans. And they'll be just reviewing it and telling us if there are any red flags. For instance, if it's a project that would need some A&R permitting, they'll let us know that. Or if the Department of Agriculture has provided funding to this project already or could provide funding. That's the kind of thing that they'll be looking at and commenting on. But they're not doing scoring or this is good or this is bad. They're just letting us know if there are any issues or if there's alternative funding or that the project has already gotten funding from that particular agency. All the scoring and the reviews, two regional partners, the agency's two regional partners in this area, will also review the applications, the Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation and the Wyndham Regional Commission. We'll will also have an opportunity to review the applications and provide comment.
And we should also say that a summary of each application will be on the Go Wyndham website, and there'll be an opportunity and an email address if the public wishes to comment. It'll be a summary, not the full application.
So once we receive all the applications, there'll be a link on the website you can go to, and there'll be a list of all the applications, and you can click on each one and see the summary of the application. Once the scoring and review have occurred, that'll come back to staff, and if there's any other due diligence that needs to be done, we'll do that. If there are any questions that have come up from the review teams, that'll be researched, and then the staff will write up a summary of all of that for the Vermont Economic Progress Council, which I mentioned is a board of 11 citizens from around the state, and they will review the applications and do a process similar to what the Community Development Board does with the applications for through the Community Development Block Grant Program, where they're looking at all the applications, prioritizing them, and allocating the $2 million to the applications that have come in, whether it be grants or loans. And in the meantime, when the applications are going through the scoring and review process, the loan applications would go to VITA, left out that important part, and they'll do the underwriting that they would normally do on loan applications for loans through this program. The loan program that they'll be setting up is different than what they already offer. And so once all that review is done, it would come back to the VEPSE staff and be submitted to the VEPSE board for allocation and review prioritization. And they'll put together a package for the governor. And the governor makes the final decisions on the applications. As far as the timeline goes for all of that, as I mentioned, we hope to release the application and the notice of funding availability within the next 2 weeks. Whenever that goes out, the applications will be due 60 days later, and then the review process will take through October, and VEPSE board will hold a meeting in Brattleboro to do the initial review of the applications, and we'll ask the applicants to come and do a brief presentation on their applications. And then, if necessary, we'll hold a second meeting probably 2 weeks later to do the final, depend on how many applications there are. We just don't know how many they're going to be yet. And so it could take all day to do all the reviews at that first meeting. So we'll probably have a second meeting where the final allocations and prioritization will occur and put together the package to the governor. So we're targeting November 6th for that meeting. Then send it on to the governor at that point.
Who makes the final decisions? So, and let me just quickly run through, the program priorities for the entire $10 million or $2 million a year is to promote economic development in Wyndham County, clearly. We also want to see that projects make a direct link to the goals and objectives of the Southeast Vermont Economic Development Strategy's Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy, that it leads to job creation and retention, does not duplicate existing efforts, and leverages other existing local, regional, and state funds. So those are broad priorities. We have really two basic threshold criteria. In other words, each application should be able to articulate how it will promote economic development in Wyndham County and how it meets a goal or objective identified in the Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy. So there are other criteria that every project will be judged against. That will all be released when we release the final application and what the final process is. So, and all this material, drafts, right, frequently asked questions, public comments we've received so far, are all on the gowyndham.vermont.gov website. And when the application, as Fred said, is released, it'll all live on that website too. So everybody will be able to take a look at it. So with that, what we'd love to do is get started with folks who wish to speak. We're going to ask every person to restrict their comments to 3 minutes per person. We have a number of people who'd like to speak. Once they're done, we'll open it up to anybody else who'd like to speak. I don't know that you need to go to the microphone
Come to the microphone, state your name, And if you have a written version of your testimony, just hand it to me, and I'll be just writing some copious notes on the board there. If you think I got something, wrote something down completely wrong, just let me know, and I'll amend it. But I'm just trying to put the big ideas on there.
And I'm gonna time everybody in my nifty-difty little stopwatch here, so I'll give you the hook right around 2 minutes and 50 seconds. So our first speaker is Howard Fairman.
Howard Fairman, Vernon, a private citizen. Laying groundwork for eventual job creation is hopeful speculation. If we build it, they will come. Creating jobs is entrepreneurial innovation. They are here, we are building it. The Windham County Revolving Loan Fund, proposed by the Vermont Agency of Commerce and Community Development, should utilize the entire $10 million made available through the Memorandum of Understanding between the State of Vermont and Energy Vermont Yankee. A revolving loan fund is ideal because repayments are loaned again in perpetuity, fostering perpetual prosperity. While the $10 million are to promote economic development in Windham County, the initial intent is to mitigate direct economic impacts of losses of hundreds of highly skilled, well-paid jobs at a closing nuclear power plant. The Windham County Revolving Loan Fund, therefore, should focus for now on economic development directly benefiting Windham County towns facing these direct economic impacts by helping to finance creation of replacement private sector jobs and parlaying these successes countywide. We should train and foster Windham County Vermonters as private sector innovators reinventing the Windham County economy. Recently participating in a weekend Dartmouth College innovative business planning workshop with an inspiring leader based in Silicon Valley, California, I learned that its climate of world-class innovation is first open and cooperative, then competitive. We should hire him to present these workshops in Windham County, as he told me that he can do, naturally creating an innovators network among the participants. The impartial Vermont Economic Development Authority should solicit, facilitate, evaluate, and select these innovative business plans as a service to Windham County and as an example for the rest of Vermont, coordinating existing local revolving loan funds, the Windham County Revolving Loan Fund, and grassroots venture capital raised via the Vermont Small Business Offering Exemption. Southeastern Vermont Economic Development Strategies, CVEDS, have requested that they be represented in official decisions regarding this Vermont Yankee financial windfall. Proposed by some established business, nonprofit, and government organizations having vested interests in the status quo and in benefiting from this financial windfall, CVEDS vital projects would lay more groundwork so that job creation may happen, but do not make it happen, except for those who are laying more groundwork. CVEDS inherently lack necessary vision and independence to solicit, facilitate, evaluate, and select innovative business plans reinventing the Windham County economy. Instead of speculative, if we build it, they will come, innovative, they are here, we are building it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Howard. And our next speaker is Sally Fegley.
I'm Sally Fegley, and I work at Omega Optical. I don't have a comment, but I have a question. From what I understand, there are no financing terms that are going to be prescribed. So I wondered how wide-ranging the applications could be by way of financing terms. I mean, could it be an application, for instance, for a zero interest payment? Could there be balloon payments at the end of the term? Is it totally up to the applicant to define the terms the applicant wants? Or will you be coming out with terms?
We'll be coming out with
Please.
Okay. We will be coming out with terms. What we're here to hear from you is, you know, what are some of those terms you'd like to see? We currently can be very flexible. You know, if we have a loan application, we can talk with the person and say, well, you know, if it's, let's say it's a startup, not too many of those probably will be funded with this because we're really looking for, you know, job creation, which isn't to say that startups don't create jobs, so I need to retract that. So we can work with the customer to say, you know, would 6 months no interest help you? Probably the interest rate is going to be somewhere around 2%, so it's going to be a low interest loan fund.
The plan now is to loan up to $350,000 per borrower, and we picked that number so that we could do it in-house, so that we wouldn't have to go to our board of directors, which only meets once a month. But no, we'll be definitely coming out with terms, but some of those terms could definitely be modified between VITA and the borrower.
And we're really looking for that kind of input tonight, Sally, so if you feel like...
Obviously, you know, the lower the interest and the longer the payment.
Right, absolutely, sure.
Everything else. Oh, so will you be indicating whatever restrictions there are in the application, request for application?
Yes.
That will be indicated there.
Right, yeah, we'll put that kind of information out, but I think Joe's point too is we can be pretty flexible, and we can look at some pretty flexible tools depending on what the need is, and what we're really looking at is where do you see some of the opportunity in terms of flexibility?
Okay, well, at Omega, we have some thoughts, so... You know,
we'd love to hear
we'll
them.
We'll be developing those.
Yep. Please feel free to follow up. We do have a on the website. There's a address for comments, and/or you could follow up directly with VITA. There.
Send it to me, and I can send it to Fred. However, you can send it to Fred, and he'll send it to me.
And your emails are on the website, right?
Indeed. Uh-huh. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Sally. And now we have Tom Fegley.
Hi, I'm Tom Fegley, I'm also Omega Optical. We have a development project in mind, and it's usually difficult to get development kind of funding from a conventional lender. We have patterned it mostly along the lines of getting development grants from the federal government, in which you receive a certain amount of funding, reach a goal, then you get a second stage funding, get another target, and then finally a third stage.
Like SBIR? Or?
Yes, yeah, okay. Say over a period of 18 months in our need. We would hire highly technical technicians, an engineer perhaps, for the initial phase of the development work. We would expect to be able to create a mock-up of our device after 6 months, and we would need additional funding at that time. And then finally, we would expect to produce, say, 10 of these instruments out of field testing. And then at the end of that 18-month period, we, if the project were successful, we'd seek conventional funding at that time to ramp up to a marketing project to what we believe would be thousands of organizations around the country. So I presume this is something that you have in mind, and we would want the kind of development terms that are generally not favorable to a bank. In other words, we would not wish to make any debt service payments, at least for the first 6 months, perhaps a year. We'd want interest to accrue. We'd probably be willing to start payments after the first year and then have a balloon payment at the end of the term. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm not telling you, I'm not saying yes, I'm saying that's absolutely the kind of a loan application we would love to
right.
see, and we certainly hope you would apply.
Yep, great. Thank you very much, Tom. Next.
Go ahead. One thing I should add is that we see this as being in partnership with the banks, and I see Dan in there. I know there's some other bankers here, so that it doesn't have to be all the BY money, all VITA money,
right.
or all bank money. We see it as some revolving loan fund money. So I think it's going to be a real opportunity to put together some different sources of funding, which will help projects exactly like you're speaking about.
And Fred spoke to the scoring criteria, and the leveraging of funds is an element of the scoring criteria. So, and it's not intended that you would come to this source instead of, but rather in addition to, so that we're leveraging as many other resources as can be. And one of the benefits of VITA is they have a lot of different loan programs and are aware of other resources. So, okay, next is Spoon Agave.
Spoon Agave, my comment on the process is to stop it and sit on that money. Everything I have heard so far is based on traditional economic thinking, thinking that has been developing for 400 or 500 years. You're all probably somewhat familiar with economics. Look at the economics in the world today. That system, that traditional system, is based on short-term thinking. Profits now, results now. If anybody thought in the future, it was 10 or 20 years. The future that those people that have been developing the economics we now live with is not the future that the world is now looking at. And consequently, the economic system that got us here is not going to adequately respond to the future that we are looking at. It is, I feel, very important that we don't rush into projects and use this money helter-skelter everywhere on anything that looks like it can make a quick buck here and there, and really think about what the world's going to look like and how we have to adjust what we do. It's a world that is going to be far more based on human rights, on poverty, equity, and many other issues. It cannot be any longer based on profits. That kind of thinking and that development is guaranteed to fail. I urge that for right now, until we get sorted out, that the state just sits on this money, invests it, lets it add a little bit through interest, and when we really feel safe and secure about what we want to do with it, and do have a real sense of agreement in the community, then it will be time to go ahead and use it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Spoon. And next is Dick DeGray.
Allow me to comment on the website.
Oh, sorry.
I went through today. It's gowindhambt.gov.
You sure about that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
I could have sworn I saw it. Oh, are, yeah, really?
Yeah, really.
Well, how come I'm getting there through gowindham.vermont? Anyway. Okay. Sorry. Yeah, there it is. It gets you both ways, I guess.
That may be the worst.
Okay. So, no?
Not too much.
Okay. Well, it keeps working for me, Rod, but either or. So maybe I've got some sort of karmic connection. Who knows? But, thank you. Sorry, Dick. Thank you.
I hope you weren't using my time.
Not at all. God, no. Look, I'm pressing start right now.
I know people try to limit me when I get up in front of the microphone. I want to talk to you a little bit about grants, which there is no real definition about it. And I'm a believer in beautification is economic development. I think when I look at Wilmington, I look at Hanover, New Hampshire as places that are well-flowered, well-decorated throughout the year. You enjoy going to those communities. It draws you to those communities. We started a program here in town, but we're funding it with holy pictures and rosary beads. So I would like to apply for a grant. And one of the things that I hope that happens, that there's real accountability that this money is given out, and if it's grant money, to make sure that it's used for what it was intended to be used for. And so I'd like to talk to you further at a later time about who I would apply, whether it would be through the town, who would administer the money if it was accepted, so it didn't come directly to me, so you can make sure that it was used for what it was intended to. My comment also, yesterday listening to the governor talking about 3% unemployment in the state of Vermont. How do we attract people to come to the jobs that we're trying to create? One of the things I hope that you do think about is stipends for potential living stipends for a year or fuel stipends for people who live outside of our region that would come in for some of these jobs created with parameters that it would be a grant if you stayed for X amount of years in that job, or you would have to pay it back if you left before you reached those parameters. Mm-hmm. And I really think that you have to think about stuff like that. We want to create jobs. We don't have people to fill those jobs. Being a former select board member, I have met with numerous businesses that says we have jobs, we don't have people. Mm-hmm. So attracting younger people or people with limited means to come into your community. They need to start, and I think that that's one thing you should seriously consider as part of this revenue is some stipend money. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dick. And I'd just say that workforce development clearly is an activity that would be eligible under this funding, and an application such as that could be entertained. So thank you for that, Dick. Then we're moving down to Penelope. Am I getting that right? No, Penelope is a maybe.
As a maybe.
Are you a maybe or still?
I have actually had one of the question zones, was that I was, wondering if you were having businesses looking for loans, what was the rate? Because I certainly wouldn't want to be making an application if I then found out that the rate was a lot higher than the rate that I am currently getting from my bank. Mm-hmm. But I did also just want to press the point that I'm a small business. I'm a very small business. I probably have 3 part-time employees, and I'm sure there are many of us here in Brattleboro and in Windham County, and that collectively we do bring a lot to the community. And I think it would be great if somebody could set aside one of those $38,000 and put it into a pool, which could then be, put out as smaller micro grants to companies which need it. For example, I had a suggestion for a really long time that it would be great if I could have a micro grant for advertising, because it's one of the discretionary things that I have each year, and I don't advertise very much. And so I'm not supporting the local nonprofits because I'm not advertising in their things. And if somebody was matching that, I'd be much more likely to put my money into it. Do you know what I mean? Uh-huh. Spend that money. Uh-huh. So that's just something to think about. Thank you. Listen.
Thank you, Penelope. And Peggy Farbaugh.
Thank you, Secretary Moulton and panel. It's an honor to be here with this crowd of people who are really looking to the future of Windham County. There's a lot of high-powered intelligence and enthusiasm here. So I live in Vernon, and it's my personal mission to bring as much of this funding to the town of Vernon as possible. So I have a couple questions. One is, can you clarify whether this money is exclusive to Windham County?
Yes.
No one out of Windham County will be entertained.
Correct.
Okay, so that's great.
Statewide organizations who might do projects for Windham County, but it has to be activity in Windham County.
Okay, so that's really encouraging.
And any revolving loan fund would recycle back to Windham County.
Right. It will always remain on Vita's books as restricted for the Windham County revolving loan fund.
Okay, thank you. So the town of Vernon has some projects that in mind that we've kind of been thinking about for many years. One would be like, we don't have any water and sewer in Vernon. So I don't know how many jobs that would generate, but it would help the town of Vernon to be a place where businesses would want to come. So would that be something that would be eligible?
Potentially, and we'd have to know where the job creation potential could come from that, and clearly look to leverage other existing sources of funds but infrastructure is clearly an eligible activity.
Infrastructure,
yes.
That's great.
Yep.
So there's other enrichment sort of things in Vernon that maybe the Historical Society might want to do, or the Rec Center might want to do. Would those things be eligible? We have to kind of recreate our community. We have to kind of keep bolstering it.
It depends on the project, Peggy, and what's involved and where the potential for sustained economic activity and job creation would come from.
Okay, but you're not saying no.
No.
So that's good. Okay. And then the other thing I would just like to encourage, and a number of people have already said it tonight, is that, you know, businesses could really use the grants. I can speak personally because I got a grant last year from the Working Lands grants. And it's really helped me in my business to kind of get stronger to the point where we can start paying back some of our loans. So, you know, businesses, in order to get off the ground, we have a lot of debt already. And I would just really support and ask you to support giving some grants to small businesses.
Okay. Great.
Thank you.
Thank you, Peggy. Next is Janet Rasmussen. Thank you. Sorry, Janet, I'm going to tear apart your name. My apologies.
Also from Vernon. And I don't really have, I don't have any comments as much as I just have a question, a couple questions.
Certainly.
I agree with Peggy that, are you, is the plan now that nonprofits get grants and businesses get loans, or have you not really made that final decision yet?
Well, at the moment, businesses would get loans, but nonprofits could get loans, and municipalities could get loans. We're not really restricting who gets loans, other than, as the governor explained yesterday, and as we're fairly adamant, is we want to see this money recycle. But nonprofits, municipalities, et cetera, may also apply for grants.
Because I guess that was my big question. You laid out in good detail yesterday what you were looking for in terms of a return on investment for a mm-hmm. loan and what small businesses need to do. And I guess my concern was just if too many grants are given out, obviously then the equation becomes really lopsided mm-hmm. and the fund can't continue to replenish itself.
Right.
So that was my urging, was just that not that as little money as possible, although I understand what Peggy said and I completely agree with her that, you know, the loan to grant ratio stays in such a way that, you know, it will be revolving hopefully into perpetuity. And my only other question was, you said that all of the money is going back into the jobs, but I thought there was like a couple of $100,000 a year coming out for admin costs.
Yep. Yes, there's. We've indicated up to 10% could be spent on things like marketing and capacity and feasibility studies and things of that nature. So that is considered. Am I right on that, Fred? We're looking at a maximum of $200,000 a year
right.
in those types of activities.
The way we had, at this point, operationally, is not to set it aside, but of all the applications that come in, a limitation of 10% or $200,000 each fiscal year for marketing, feasibility studies, planning studies.
Oh, okay, so that's a fungible number, too, at this point. So nothing really, right. as you said, has been written in stone at this point.
We can adjust as our experience gets better and we get a sense of what's going on in terms of applications, absolutely.
Okay, and my only other comment is I appreciate what you've talked about in terms of transparency going forward. That's really wonderful. I
Great.
Think that will help a lot. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Janet. Okay, next we have Kate Anderson.
Kate Anderson. I'd like to speak to the needs of the creative industries. Industrial clusters are naturally occurring collections of related businesses and interests that, by their shared existence, create a pool of knowledgeable labor, inform supporters, education institutions aligned with their needs. Examples would be Silicon Valley, New York in finance, the Detroit auto industry, Houston in oil, and thank you to Jeff Lewis for that definition. A coordinated subset of the creative industries, the largest industry cluster in the Brattleboro area, is primed for advancement through the Southeast Vermont Initiative for Arts Enterprises. Sevier is a program to address needs of micro enterprises of the creative industries. I would hope this effort will recognize the need to enable new, innovative micro-enterprises, especially in the creative industries, through mentorship and startup grants. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kate. And last on the formal list to speak, I believe, is Bob Oser.
Thank you. Bob Oser, Brattleboro. So I think the first piece on my bullet is to look again at the criteria and tweak them a bit. I think I put in former public comment to look at the law and look at Title 10, Section 3 of the Vermont Statutes Annotated. There are four goals of economic development. I think somehow those goals need to be incorporated in the criteria to give an overall breadth to this program. Collaboration is one of them, an emphasis on infrastructure, the small scale of Vermont, and its diverse economy. So there are pieces there that I think need to be emphasized. The criteria now seem to not have value in the sense they're not value laden, and usually you don't want value laden, but I think here you do because it's already in statute. The other piece I would go to is the enabling legislation to Section 3 was Act 54 of 2009. And it has too many paragraphs to read. I'll be way beyond the time limit. One paragraph said, Vermonters are struggling to secure basic needs such as health care, child care, affordable housing, and quality education. These basic needs are, and here's the punchline, these basic needs are prerequisites to, rather than the product of, economic development. I think this process needs to honor that finding in Act 54. So, two quick examples. So one day of the week I work in retail. I work for the discount. But what blows me away is people, customers coming in work uniforms, paying for food items with EBT. That blows me away. 2 days a week, I volunteer at a kitchen, a community kitchen, which serves meals to anyone in need of a meal. That means you have to step up and we serve you on a plate. You have to go through that experience in order to eat. The other day, I was blown away because one of the customers on that line was wearing a work uniform. I know some other people there who are working, but they don't have uniforms. So that experience, so those experiences lead me to a question that I have. And it's about this mix of loans and grants and how do we do this revolving loan fund and all the rest of it. And the concept of loss appetite. So what kind of risk are you going to take?
Okay. We need to wrap up, so if you want to get to your question, that'd be great.
Okay, so these are just questions. I have no comments from here on in. Since 2008, and someone said even earlier, maybe 2006, right? How much money has been spent on economic development in Windham County? State money, federal money, local money, CDBG money. In that time, how much of that has been spent on study, administration, and research? And the most important part of that question, what has been the return on that investment measured in specific outcomes? Changes in median wage, adjusted for inflation, number of jobs created. That's the loss appetite we've come accustomed to. And that includes loans, grants, all of it, all of that money. What has been the return on investment? Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, Bob. I can just, it's not since 2006, but I actually do have some data, just FYI. I can't answer the ROI question for you right now, but the community development program, since its start in 83, has been awarded over $30 million to Windham County, which is the second largest in the state to receive community development funds county, behind Washington County at $33 million. And I do have a breakdown of what some of that funding is. So there's a fair amount of community development block grant money that's been here in Windham County over the years, plus municipal planning grants, et cetera. So I do have some numbers on that, but I can't give you the ROI. So that's the end of our folks who formally wish to comment, and I suspect there are maybe one or two others who think maybe they do have something want to say, and I'm thinking Martin Langeveld is one of them. So thank you, Martin.
I wasn't going to say anything, but I'm listening to the comments about urging you to consider grants to businesses in addition to loans. And I know that limitation is something that's probably very near and dear to the governor's heart, and so it probably isn't going to happen. But I think it's really an important thing to consider. And I would urge you to look at the Maine Technology Initiative, which has been at this with a very similar model as we're talking about here for a very long time. They get about $5 or $6 million a year to apply to the entire state, and they've created thousands and thousands of jobs. They're very well documented. They get about a 15-to-1 match, private funds to the public funds that go into it, and all of it goes into job creation. It works. It goes to basic businesses all around Vermont. It doesn't have to be high tech, all around Maine. It doesn't have to be high tech, cutting edge, fancy businesses. You know, it goes to paper mills and all kinds of much more basic industries like we have here. But the important part of that model is that there are three levels of investment that MTI does. The first level is R&D grants. They're outright grants for research and development, the kind of work that here the gentleman from Omega was talking about, where you know you've got to venture a little bit of investment to see if you've got a viable product, or you've got to develop a market or a process or something like that. And those are smallish grants in Maine, and then, you know, as a second level, the businesses that have, once they've gotten an R&D grant, then they become eligible for the revolving loan fund. And then, if their business really takes off, they have a larger level of investment, which is actually equity investment into those businesses. And that's how that works. The other thing about grants is that it allows you to think about smaller grants. The word micro grant came up here a few times. You know, if you have a $25,000 minimum, which I think was mentioned here, you know, a Penelope Words store is not going to be able to apply for that. But and in terms of loans, I understand that you don't want to be dealing with very small loans on the order of $1,000, $5,000, $10,000. But if you talk about grants, you can really micro-target with micro-grants, and you can have an impact, you know, at the level of a business that has one or two employees. If they can hire another one or two employees, they've doubled their size.
Right.
You know, if the biggest business in town can hire one person, that's a 1% increase, maybe. So again, I urge you to really think about changing that requirement by grant.
Great. Grants. Thank you, Martin. Anybody else who has decided they, or if there are any questions anybody has, you don't need to necessarily get up and speak, but if there are questions, Mr. Francis.
Hi, Pat. Actually, I'm going to put my technocrat hat on here. So. So maybe you can let me know and let the audience know at what point more refined criteria are going to be developed. So in the past, when we've operated our own revolving loan fund in Brattleboro for small businesses, or we've worked with local businesses or not-for-profits for CDBG funds or something similar, there's a lot of background work that goes on in the BCDP office and in other places, right. Vita as well, to check on the financial status of the institutions and organizations that are applying for it, and there is a sort of a back and forth to some extent about collateral, you know, the risk, whether the interest rate is going to reflect some kind of risk and those kinds of things. So it seems at this point the whole discussion is extremely broad. and we haven't gotten that far yet.
Right.
But it seems as if very soon, according to Fred, the money's going to be out there, and those details are going to end up being important, I suspect.
Absolutely.
So can you outline at least what the process is for developing some guidance there for institutions such as the town or even BDCC and Windsor Regional Commission, who are going to be at least imparting some general information to potential applicants as to whether they're viable or not,
right,
on the basis of their financial history?
Yeah, I mean, and Joe and or Fred, please feel free to jump in, but when we put application materials out there, we'll be clear what those criteria and terms are, but I don't want to speak for Joe. There's very likely to be some of that back and forth like you see in the community development program.
I mean, as I say right now, and we really wanted to hear from you all before we came down. We didn't want to come down here with a program set in stone and say, okay, this is what we're doing. We really felt it was important to hear from you. So within the next few days?
Within the next week.
We're going to have it together. Right now, I'm not hearing any objections to $350,000. That seems to be up to $350,000. 2% interest rate. I didn't hear any, God no, to that. Terms. Did you say God no? God, I missed it. I know everybody wants 0%. I get that. And I think there will be, those will be the basic parameters that will be structured. But as with any loan application, there will be back and forth with the borrower and with whoever's representing the borrower.
And as far as overall application eligibility, the program criteria are out there with a description of each of the scoring criteria. And when the application is out in a few weeks, it'll make it a little clearer about what you're going to have to file to with the application to provide evidence and satisfy those criteria. It's, as I mentioned, very similar to the CDBG, but we don't have those federal requirements to meet, so we're trying to make it a little more flexible, a little less onerous. A lot of what Joe will require for the loans will be similar to what they require now, like you mentioned collateral. You'll have to, there'll be something you have to file about collateral, but for the grants and just overall eligibility, it'll follow those criteria very closely, and you'll be sending in narratives and material to back up the how you meet those criteria, and it'll help the scorer score each application.
Did you want to add something, Jeff?
Well, I one of the things we really haven't touched on much is risk parameters and risk profiles. I'm thinking that we have a lot of experience with different types of loan programs that do have different risk profiles. We do agricultural lending. That's pretty high risk stuff sometimes. Not always, but it can be. We do technology lending. Again, that's a pretty high risk profile, and very much like probably what's going on in Maine. And I feel badly that we haven't gotten out, all the things that we do, because when you're describing the Maine Technology Initiative, it's very similar to the things we do at GVITA, except for the R&D grants, and I hear you about that. So I see this fund, and I'd like to hear if anybody doesn't agree with this, that there should be a little bit more of a risk tolerance in this particular loan fund, then we might. I'm not saying that we're going to lend to businesses that can't pay us back, because we always try not to do that. But I think this has a little of a different kind of a bent to it than some of the other straight loan programs that we lend in.
Let's make it a spoon and then come back to you.
I'm sorry.
I was just going to respond to her.
Oh, sorry.
About, being on the select board in Brattleboro and being part of the small business loan program, we have had people that we have bad debt, and we do a lot of research into the loans that we've given out.
Sure.
So I can understand your leniency here, but the governor also said $10 million isn't really a lot of money.
I know.
And when you're talking about $350,000 shots at one time, I would hope that there is a little bit of scrutiny. They're coming here because they're having a hard time with a bank getting money, but to get a $350,000 loan and then walk away from that, that revolving loan fund is not going to last long.
Precisely.
No, and absolutely not, of course not.
Okay, and Spoon and then Laura.
In the same vein, I was wondering if you could explain how a member of the public can monitor where all the money has gone and the results. Can we look up how many jobs each project created, what wages are being paid, what taxes are being collected, etc.?
Fred, do you want to?
At each round, when the applications are filed, we'll be posting a list of the applicants, what they requested, and a brief, outline of a brief project description on the website. And this is the correct website. We'll have a list of all the applicants. And then when the award's awarded, it will list, we'll add what the award was for each one. All applicants will be reporting on an annual basis, and we'll aggregate that data and report the data on the jobs created, the, whatever the goals of each application were, and
here it is.
What the results were. Taxes, I'm not sure we're reporting on taxes paid, but there'll be a report. There'd be information on the website about who applied, what they asked for, what the award was, and then annual results of the ongoing results of the program.
I should mention that in the state of Vermont, when we make grants, they are performance-based grants. So there will be measures and outcomes that will be required in every grant agreement. And so we will know what does the application propose to do, and then how well did they do it by virtue of annual reports. So those kinds of requirements will be of every applicant. I don't know that we've gotten as far as to say will be required of every VITA applicant, but that's something we can talk about. So. But certainly, that kind of information will be published on the website. And to the website, if you got there through gowyndham.vt.gov, fabulous. But that is the URL we've paid for. But apparently more than one works, which is a good thing. So, but just so watch the website would be the main point. Laura.
Just a quick question on criteria. Mm-hmm. So small businesses here, as you know, have really taken a hit in the region, first with the recession, then with Irene, and they haven't really started to take the hit that the loss of $60 million a year in payroll is going to put on the existing small businesses that are here. A question was asked of me to ask you, which is regarding credit card debt. After Irene, a number of small business owners fixed them. You know this.
Yep.
Quick, put it on their cards. And, we've done a lot of work to help business owners get back on their feet and move on, and nothing has been able to refinance that credit card debt. So I've been asked to put that on the table. And it's relative because this is going to be the triple win.
Right.
At some point, they just can't come back.
Well, and refinancing, Joe can speak to that, but that's always an extraordinarily difficult thing to do. I would defer to some of the bankers here. And I guess, if there are a business that is impacted by the loss of a customer that is Vermont Yankee, and they wish to, let's say, apply for a loan to look at diversifying their business and expanding their business to accommodate that loss because we're moving into something else or we're looking to doing something different so that we can either retain or create new jobs, that would be very appropriate. But we're not necessarily going to do a disaster recovery loan type program. We're not necessarily looking at saying, okay, I did $1 million in business with VY, now I'm doing $500,000. What I need is for you to give me that other half. That's not what we're targeting this funding at. We're targeting the money at creating new economic development activity, creating economic development opportunities, job creation, business opportunities that are going to add add new vitality, and so we're really looking for that business who's impacted to be able to say to us, with this money, I can do this new thing, which will enable me to retain my employment base, retain my business, and so that may be an interesting distinction. And refinancing credit card debt.
Well, I always say this, you know, money's fungible, and a working capital loan.
That's a good point.
May go to make your payroll, when in fact the money that you have goes to pay off your credit card debt. But technically, we cannot refinance. And I want to say something to you, because I don't want you to think we're going to take the money and just throw it away. I mean, our loss rate right now is about 1%. So even if we double our loss rate with this, we're still going to be good stewards with this money.
Dan.
Thank you. A couple of comments and then a question. One, you know, having had a number of years' experience working with Vida, as a banker, I'm very comfortable with the process that organization uses when it is considering loan applications. I think they have a fine staff of very capable lenders who can underwrite the way that the loan should be underwritten. I am happy to hear that perhaps the risk tolerance will be a little lighter, but I would also say don't make it too late.
Gotcha.
Also, I would suggest that consideration might be given to utilizing a test similar to what the SBA does, Joe, in that have you tried for bank debt? Will a bank give you a loan? Mm-hmm. You know, that test. Mm-hmm. Can't get the financing anywhere else. I'm coming to this revolving loan fund. At the same time, the comments about leveraging other resources, and I'll admit this is somewhat self-serving. You know, we want to be one of those resources.
Well, absolutely.
You know, the 504 program, even if you applied it to a commercial and industrial type credit as opposed to a real estate credit, a bank's going to feel a lot differently about the risk that some of these loans might present to it if we're going in at 50%
correct.
Instead of 80%.
Right. So, that's what we see, Dan. We see, you know, you guys very much like we do now in the Subchapter 5 program with the parameters a little different. Maybe you guys coming in only at 40%, or, you know, then we have some Vida money in there, then we have some VY money in there, maybe we have some local money. Be nice if the borrower could put some equity in, but that
Absolutely.
May not always be able to happen, but... You know, we're going to run it very much the way we do now, but I think this is an art, and I do have great lenders, and we've been doing it for a long time. So finding the balance between economic development and prudent lending is different in every single project, and thank God I have good lenders that can do that.
I do want to say too that listening to what other folks are saying. You know, I understand how people feel about grants versus loans and you know, being socially responsible. This is about economic development. This is about, if you remember what the governor said yesterday, this is about creating jobs, raising the average wage.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah. And so we need to keep that in mind.
Absolutely.
As we go forward. Yep. One question I have in terms of process. The application's ready in a couple of weeks, and then there's a 60-day time frame during which the applications have to be submitted, and then the process goes on. I'm very happy that there are some of the local agencies that will be involved in reviewing those applications. I'm not sure about the order, but that's for you guys to figure out. My concern is this going to be a limited round? I'm not sure how to properly articulate this. I'm concerned that, oh, you can only file an application in those 60 days this year, and then there'll be a 60-day period next year, and a 60-day period the year after that. I think there has to be some greater nimbleness than that, because if an economic opportunity presented itself that required funding, I hate to see it disappear because the timing of the process says we're not taking any more applications until 6 months from now.
One thing we've discussed, Dan, is doing some bridge financing at Vida, even in the interim before this first. And obviously, we would be probably less risk tolerance with our bridge financing because we know that
It's all risk.
It may turn into long-term financing, and that may be fine, but that's one of the things we've talked about. So if there is that gap, we could perhaps help fill that.
And you know, the plan is now to have the first round coming up here in a couple of weeks. If there's funding left, go to a second round. But your point is good in terms of how can we be nimble, how can we respond to those opportunities that come up off cycle, if you will. And bridge financing is one way, but we need to look at how do we do that. So thank you for that.
And my last comment is really going to be directed more towards Laura in this process. They've got to figure out what are the companies that are going to bring those higher paying jobs to Windham County.
We have a plan, Dan.
And how do they
attract
so that we can then finance them? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dan. Senator. Excuse me, Jeanette.
Thank you. I just wanted to comment on the when Bob asked the question about the amount of money that had come into Windham County for economic development, and I think you responded something like $32 million.
$30 million, yeah. And but just VCD, just the community development program.
CDBG money. Yep. But that isn't all economic development. A lot of that
right,
is infrastructure.
Good point.
Or housing. So it is. It sounds like a lot of money for economic development, but it isn't all for that.
No, thank you for clarifying that, Jenna. That's very true.
I'd like to clarify everything that we do is on our website in our annual report. All the loans we make, the amount that each borrower gets, that's all public information. The job creation, if you were to write to me, I can get that to you. It's not published in the annual report, but that is data that we keep. We check it every quarter to make sure that people are doing what they say they were going to do.
I was actually looking more for grant in addition to loan, not simply loans.
Okay.
And in response to Dan in terms of rounds, why not FIFO, first in, first out, as opposed to rounds?
Well, it's a staff capacity question in part, and a lot of it too is, especially initially, we don't really know how many grant applications we're going to get, how many loan applications we're going to get. So we really, at least for these first probably couple rounds, want to see what that profile looks like. And we're going to be scoring projects. I mean, my personal gut is that it's going to be similar to the community development program. We're going to have, you know, $3 million in applications and $2 million to give out. So so these applications are going to be scored, and we're going to have to look at, okay, where do we get the best bang for the buck, putting it far too simply, but based on the criteria that we've put in place, and which of those $3 million in applications, as an example, would get funded. And until we really can get a sense of what does that look like, we've said for the moment, we're not going to give any kind of specific formula of how much loans and how much grants. We want to see how it comes in. But as I said in the beginning and feel quite strongly about, we can adjust. We can make changes as we have more experience and get a sense of what's out there, what the needs are. So I guess that's sort of a stay tuned. We'll have a better sense as time goes by. Jeanette?
This is a question Tom brought it up about stages. So is this, if somebody gets a loan or a grant one time, is that it? Or if they have 18 months later, they need another one, is there a possibility of that? Have you decided that, or is?
Yes, I mean,
up to 350, I think. I mean,
okay.
I'm not sure that because there's such a limited amount, there's only $2 million. So I'm not sure that you'd want to go above 350 per borrower. That's a pretty hefty chunk.
It could be staged,
definitely. I'm sorry, was that your question? Yes.
Yeah, and you're right about the 350, but there may be some really fabulous project
that comes in
that we might say it needs to be $500,000 or something of that nature. So I guess right now the current sort of floor on the grant is about $25,000 and the ceiling is $2 million from a grant application, and we've talked about the ceiling potentially being looking at 350 on a loan, and I don't know that we've talked about a minimum at all, but
no.
But certainly the, you know, little tiny loans, not so much. And again, you know, we want to leverage with other local resources, Brattleboro's revolving loan fund, Rockingham's revolving loan fund, et cetera. So I saw some other peg.
Just really related to this question. So was say an infrastructure project, could it be phased over 5 years in one application, or would you want five applications?
I think we said we'd want five applications. Yeah, yeah.
That's too long a period to stage.
Okay. And yes, sir.
Yeah. Gino, I'm married. Just a quick question and clarification on, is there going to be a basement for a loan house for small businesses?
I think we've decided that.
Well, we really haven't decided that yet. I will tell you that, you know, under, let's say, $10,000, it gets really cost prohibitive in terms of
the administrative cost.
Just administrative cost of writing up.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What would you like? What would you, I mean, let me ask you, what would you like to see as the minimum?
And we hear the micro grant and micro loan piece, and there are existing who does JobStart these days, or is there JobStart there?
There is. It's
the Community Action
Agency.
Community Action Agencies in this neck of the woods, SEVCA, Southeast Vermont Community Action, does do small micro loans and micro business lending. So that would be the place to turn to for some of the smaller loans. But we've taken the comments on the micro activity. So, yes, ma'am.
I heard you. Lynn Forrest, Newfane. I've got a question about the result of wanting to have employees hired. So does the focus need to be, if a company is going to apply for a grant, that they will have additional employees, or is it possible that they will enable other companies through whatever they're doing, their training or services, for them to increase their employment?
Well, we've certainly talked about,
For grants.
Yeah, for grants, workforce, there could be a grant to an entity that's going to do a lot of workforce work, as an example, or provide, I'm struggling, for example, that will then lead to or provide job creation as a result of that. But we are looking for permanent, full-time, year-round jobs because that's what we're losing with Vermont Yankee. So those are possibilities. This is conversation, you know, we'll have to have with staff as you develop proposals. And I guess that's the other point I want to make is we'll put information out there, but folks like Fred and others in our agency can work with folks to answer questions as you proceed through the process. Certainly, VITA's loan officers are very good at working with folks to help and assist during the process of their applications. So,
thank you.
We've got about 5 minutes left before we, we're planning on ending this public hearing. Yes, sir?
I apologize for being late. If you took $1 million of the $2 million per year, and we're going to loan it out, how much could you loan out?
$1 million.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I have a couple questions to ask.
I'm not sure I understood the question.
Right.
Here's the deal. My understanding is the governor's talked about a revolving loan fund.
Right, that's what we're here to talk about tonight. Yeah.
Can I say that that's really stupid, and I'll tell you why.
Say that.
Yes. But that's what public comment is for, to get the public to make comments.
Right, exactly.
Why is it stupid? Because banks are loaning money. And if a bank has $1 million, they can loan out $10 million. You see what I'm saying?
Yep.
So it seems really stupid to lend it out.
Well, let me just
tell you. If you took $1 million, and what's the median yearly salary?
Average annual salary statewide is $42,000. What is it in here?
Is it average or median?
No, that's average, not median. Average. Right.
Okay. If you took $1 million and you said, we're going to do 20 jobs at $50,000 a year, an extra $15,000 for health care, because we want everyone to be covered. That's what we're moving forward in the state of Vermont. It'd be about $65,000 per job, right? So you get about 20 for about $1.3 million. This is another way to approach giving out the money. You instantly create 20 jobs at $50,000, which for this area isn't bad. That money goes back into the community. It's just payroll. Companies could apply for it. We're going to do one more job. The money just goes directly, only payroll, not any sort of expenses or other things, right? That's $1.3 million. You got $700,000 left, right? All your local agencies want a little grant for this, a little grant for that, right? So $500,000 you give out to BABB or Sevens or BECC. They all want a little bit of it, and they'll do good with it, right? And that still leaves you another $300,000. I think you're better off, like, if you're loaning to what? Are we loaning to, like, startups is the idea? Entrepreneurs?
Entrepreneurs, existing businesses, new businesses.
Okay.
Could be anybody.
You're only funding those jobs for 1 year.
Exactly.
Right.
Then what happens to the
But you get innovation. Year? If you had an entrepreneur who said, oh, I could pay my salary $50,000 for the first year to get started, there's no guarantees, you see? But if you did that over 10 years, you'd have a total of 80 different jobs funded for 1 year. And if you were funding entrepreneurs, a lot of these entrepreneurs would throw in like 80 hours a week, and they're never paying themselves. If they knew their payroll was covered, potentially. This is just a potential.
Interesting.
So do you see what I think? I just want to be very clear. I'm trying to be intelligent when I say, I think a revolving loan use of this money is stupid. Because banks are making loans. If people need loans, they can get it through banks. If you're loaning to people who can't get a loan through bank, you're probably not gonna pay it back. That's why it's like, I wouldn't treat this money as loan money that should be paid back. If you can send it, and that's why I say payroll. If it goes specifically to payroll, that means people are gonna be paying rent, they're gonna be paying mortgage on their home. You can define that the money stays and is spread locally, because my understanding is if you only have $2 million, you want a multiplier effect, right? You want that $2 million to give you more than just spending $2 million, and that's why I say you focus a lot on payroll. If you gave it to organizations that are local, like a farmer's market or any of the nonprofits, and you know we're rich in nonprofits in this area, with the stipulation that it had to be spent locally. You know, they couldn't order computers, they couldn't order, you know, money that's just gonna go out of state. So that's all, I just, one citizen thinks revolving loan is stupid, I would say, just fund payroll. A new business could say, we'll bring on a new person or a new person's capacity, and it is like a grant. They know that after a year, school deals with it all the time. You know, they know they can only fund this position with this money for a year. Perhaps businesses and startups could benefit from that same thing.
So can you just tell us who you are? I'm sorry.
I'm Ian Keel, and I live in Brattleboro.
Thank you,
and
Ian.
I'm a stay-at-home dad, and I'd love to be funded for a payroll position for $50,000 for a year. I have plenty of business ideas. What I'm saying is there are probably people like me, and the idea of creating new income, people who maybe don't have a job or they want to quit their job and start a venture and know that they can get their salary covered for a year, the multiplier effect may be more beneficial than a loan.
Okay, in the last minute, time for one more question or comment. Peggy.
You've been very flexible, and you're going to be flexible, so here's this one question. Might you be flexible on this amount that the state is taking out? I'm unclear, because you had said...
Where state is not taking a penny of this money.
Okay, so all $10 million are going into loans and grants.
Precisely.
Perfect.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much for your interest and your time tonight, and we appreciate you coming out. Thank you for your comments. Stay tuned to gowyndham.vermont.gov for more information.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.